following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
It is, and it's Friday. So the weekend is, well, for me, it's an hour away. For you, it may have already started. If so, or, you know, it's still coming in a few hours, whatever. I hope you enjoy it. I hope you have wonderful, fun things planned. But I hope you're staying home or taking great precautions. So, you know, I watched last weekend Lollapalooza. Some of it was on TV. And actually, the part that I watched was the final act on Sunday night as the Foo Fighters performed. The first thing I thought was, oh my God, there's a lot of people there. This can't be good. And sure enough, you know what? It wasn't. There's a story today in Rolling Stone magazine. Let me just pull up the tweet from Brian Hyatt, who wrote the piece. So he's got a whole thread now on Twitter, and he says, breaking story I just reported out. Looks like outdoor COVID transmission is happening at music festivals where people are crammed cheek to cheek. And you're surprised about this because? So whether it was, you know, Lollapalooza last weekend, or the Dave Matthews Band, for instance, was here in South Florida last week. And my sister told me she was going, and I told her she was nuts. And she's like, well, we're going to sit on the lawn. We'll make sure we're not near anyone. We'll wear masks. Well, she texted me. She said we stayed two songs, and we were out of there because it was so crowded. The first few words of this Rolling Stone article, health officials are investigating COVID-19 outbreaks tied to two recent outdoor music festivals in Michigan and Oregon, raising new concerns about the safety of events with tightly packed crowds, even outside, as live music surges back and the more transmissible Delta variant spreads. I bring this up because, again, Lollapalooza was last week. I don't know when the new cases are going to start, but I imagine pretty soon. And as much as, look, I love going to see live music, I just think, obviously, we're not there yet, and this is really dangerous. I hope, you know, when the Foo Fighters first started, and they were one of the first bands to go out again on tour, they were very diligent. In fact, one of their first shows was really a fan show, and it was at a tiny little club in Agoura, California. That's like Calabasas area, north of L.A., called the Canyon Club, and it holds, I think, 300 to 400 people tops. But they had a policy, show proof of vaccination or a recent test, and everybody must be masked. There were protests outside of the venue because of the mask policy, but they held to it. And then they went to Madison Square Garden in New York and had the same policy. And in fact, at Lollapalooza last week, there were supposedly precautions put in place. Same kind of thing. Show proof of vaccination, show a negative COVID test within so many hours. And, well, they didn't require masks, but they did require the vaccine proof or the test. And then people breached the fences. So nobody was protected there. And again, it just ended, 4 days ago? I have a feeling we're going to start seeing cases come out of that very soon because the Delta variant is so transmissible, it's so contagious, and it moves a lot quicker than COVID Classic did or still does, I suppose. It's still out there, even though most people are not immune. And they're at risk to getting the Delta variant. So I brought up the Foo Fighters, and I watched them not because I'm a big Foo Fighters fan, but because the keyboard player Rami Jaffe is an old friend, and I love seeing him play. He's just, if you ever get the chance to watch Foo Fighters, check out the keyboard player because he's always moving back there. I met Rami God, 20 years ago now, when he was the keyboardist for the Wallflowers, you know, Jacob Dylan's band. And we've stayed in touch over the years, and he's just a great guy. And in fact, when I read about them playing at the Canyon Club and the protests outside, I asked him to come on the show, and that's when he told me, you know what, there's a big machine here, and it all centers around Dave Grohl, so I'm just little Rami, and so... Yeah, he didn't want to mess with the publicists and everybody else involved. But I'm going on and on about the Foos because they did something great yesterday. See, they are now apparently on tour, and they had a show in Kansas. Yes, the Foo Fighters were playing Kansas. And out front, in front of, I guess, the venue, were the usual suspects. You know, I'm not talking about Trumpers or anything like that. I'm talking about the Westboro Baptist Church. Remember those idiots, you know, the God hates fags people? Or people is too kind a word for them. They're not people, they're maggots. But a different kind of maggots than the ones we're used to recently. Anyway, so the Westboro Baptist Church Cretans decided to troll the Foo Fighters concert. So the Foo Fighters decided to troll the Westboro Baptist Church people. Now, and this hit my Twitter. So when I woke up this morning, it was there, and people were like, "Foo Fighters trolled Westboro Baptist with disco." And that they did. Here, let me just share the video with you for those listening on the radio, because this is, after all, a radio show, first and foremost. This is, I got the wrong window up here. I'm sorry. Hold on one second. I wanted this one. Is that right? Oh, I see what happened. Something is showing on the screen that's not supposed to. Okay. So anyway, sorry. Excuse my poor directorial skills on the video. And for those of you, you know, listening to radio, just, I apologize. Anyway, so here shows on the screen as soon as the video starts, you'll see a guy standing out on a field with a sign, and the sign reads something to this world. I don't know. Let me start playing it, and then we'll watch and listen together. So here's what happens. So they're out there trolling, and a big truck, like a flatbed truck, comes around the corner, and you hear the disco music playing. It sounds like the Bee Gees, right?
There's Dave.
Oh, there's some echo there, huh?
Yeah, in front on the right side of the long brown hair.
Alright, I don't know where the echo's coming from. Let's see if this works. Okay, so now the truck comes, and it's pulling up right in front of the protesters, and here's Dave Grohl. Everybody dance.
I got something to say.
Yeah, what do you got to say, Dave?
Because you know what?
What?
I love you.
He loves you.
I do.
Okay.
The way I look at it.
Yeah.
I love everybody.
I love everybody, he says.
Isn't that what you're supposed to do? Can't you just love everybody?
Yeah.
Because I think it's about love. That's what I think. I think we're all about love. And you shouldn't be hating. You know what you ought to be doing?
Right. You shouldn't be hating.
You should be dancing.
Dancing. Yeah.
1, 2. You know what to do, bro. Oh! Come on, boys.
And the Foo Fighters launch into You
now.
Should Be Dancing.
I saw your mama dancing. I saw her dancing. She was dancing. So we're going to sing it to you.
My baby was at midnight.
And it goes from there.
My woman takes me higher.
Anyway, so that happened. And the reason, if you're seeing the Foo Fighters doing these Bee Gees songs, there's a reason for it. And let me let you in on the joke. So every year, every summer, there's what's known as Record Store Day. So record stores, I know, I think it started as an LA thing, and I think it became a national thing, where artists would release records on vinyl. This, it was really for vinyl collectors, and limited edition runs of them for record store days, a way to get people into record stores. And so sometimes they would do special edition recordings. And that's what the Foo Fighters did this time out. They did the DGs. Get it, Dave Grohl, the DGs instead of the Bee Gees. And they did like a 5-song EP of Bee Gees covers, and it's really good. So they've been performing it live, and I just love that they somehow said, okay, Westboro Baptist Church is out here protesting us. Let's get a truck and troll them right back. And that they did. So that was fun. Thought we'd start off with something fun today. Today on the show, just to let you know what's coming up, we have, well, the Olympics are in full swing. Did you know that? I know a lot of people aren't watching the Olympics this year. And if you're not, well, it's understandable, because if you have been, you've seen how awful NBC's coverage is. Oh my God, it's just embarrassingly bad. We watched for the gymnastics, and of course, you know, we were let down because of Simone Biles' problems. Glad she participated in the last event, and glad that she, the name of the album is Hail Satin. Yes, I knew that. It's the Foo Fighters. Actually, it's the DG's Hail Satin, as opposed to Satan. Yeah. Anyway, so Simone Biles did finally participate in the final apparatus competition in the women's gymnastics, the balance beam, and she got a bronze medal, and that was good. And you know, the drama around her, I don't want to say injury, her malady, perhaps her mental issues, I'm sure brought on by stress and other things. The fact that Larry Nassar, the doctor, the alleged doctor who molested her and so many other members of the USA women's gymnastics team, was in the news just as the Olympics were getting started, might have something to do with the fact that she suffered a little bit of anguish at the start of the games. Do you recall? He was in the news because for some reason he wasn't required to pay restitution to all his victims, but he was allowed by the prison authorities to spend tens of thousands of dollars on crap for himself, creature comforts, as it were, I suppose. So no doubt that Simone Biles, who is the last member of the women's gymnastics team who was a victim of his, it had to affect her. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. I'm just bringing it up to tell you that our guest today is Jules Boykoff. He's written a number of books on the Olympics. He's a former Olympic athlete. He didn't play in the Olympics, but he was a member of the men's soccer, Olympic soccer team, and played in international competition, and has written, as I said, a number of books on it, dealing with the politics of the Olympics. And he and I spoke the first time and the last time, really, 5 years ago, right before the Olympics in Rio. And so we're going to pick up that conversation, because there's a lot of stuff that went on that NBC never reported on. Go figure. So we will talk about that. He'll join us at the bottom of the hour. Big story today happens to be, no, not Joe Biden's tan suit. Although, you got to hand it to him. That's, I guess, you know how the Republicans are always trying to own the libs? I think Joe Biden owned the cons today, because he came out into the press room to talk about the excellent jobs numbers. The July jobs report came out today, and we added, 900, and I don't have the numbers in front of me, it's something like 947,000 jobs, 943,000 jobs, close. And the unemployment rate fell from 5.9%. last month to 5.4% now, better than expected. I think they were expecting 850,000 jobs. They got almost 100,000 more than that. So good news. He came out to deliver and decided to do it in a tan suit. You know what? love him or hate him, you gotta applaud that, because you remember Obama came out in the tan suit. It was such a scandal. Impeach him, a tan suit. Oh my God, what is he thinking about? And if you looked on Twitter today, the entire press corps always making tan puns and things like that. So anyway, so that happened, but that's not what I was going to talk about. A lot of eyes and attention is now focused on Cori Bush. Cori Bush, new congresswoman from the St. Louis, Missouri area. And Cori Bush has been a homeless person in her life. She was an activist. She was a Black Lives Matter activist who really got involved, I believe, after Michael Brown's killing in the Ferguson protests. And she parlayed that into her congressional seat. And last week, she really took up for the millions of Americans who were in danger of being evicted starting last weekend when the eviction moratorium expired. And she said, nope, I've been there, can't let this happen. And so she staged a protest, a nonviolent, peaceful protest on the steps of the Capitol. She slept there for 4 nights. And basically at the end of that, Biden gave in. He said, although the Supreme Court kind of said we really can't extend the eviction moratorium, we're going to try it anyway. And what he said was there will likely be challenges, but maybe it'll buy us enough time that the states can finally distribute the billions of dollars we've already allocated for renters and landlords relief. There's money there to help these people. They don't all have to be evicted. It shouldn't have taken this to get to that point. They should have already distributed the funds. But anyway, Biden said, all right, we'll do it to, you know, get along, to go along and hopefully get some of this money distributed in the meantime and help everybody out. So that happened. And Cori Bush was the darling of the Democrats. I mean, after Biden made the announcement, Chuck Schumer, Chucky Schmucky himself, came running out onto the Capitol steps and gave her a big hug. And he's like, oh, you did it. And followed by a number of other senators, all, you know, celebrating Cori Bush. That's good. She deserves it. Well, then, you know, a lot of people wanted to interview her. And that they did. So CBS television sent out a reporter to the Capitol steps, and it was a long interview. All we've heard ad nauseum really is this 30 seconds that I'm about to play for you. But I guess that's all you need as we operate on, you know, short attention span time here in the U.S. So this is what Cori Bush said during that interview that all of a sudden made her the pariah of the Democratic Party.
The thing, I won't let them get that off. You can't get that off. I'm going to make sure I have security, because I know I have had attempts on my life and I have too much work to do. There are too many people that need help right now for me to allow that. So if I end up spending $200,000, if I spend $10 more dollars on it, you know what? I get to be here to do the work. So suck it up, and defunding the police has to happen.
What?
We need to defund the police and put that money into social safety nets.
Okay, what she was talking about there is Cori Bush has been getting death threats. And so it's been revealed that over the last few months, remember, January 6th, that was over 6 months ago already. Over the last few months, she has spent $70,000 on private security because of the death threats she's been getting. And so she came under fire for that, and they asked her about it. And that's why she said, if I spend $200,000 or another $10, it doesn't really matter. I have work to do. I need to be here to do it. If I'm dead, obviously I can't do the work. That was all well and good. And then she said, but we have to defund the police. Now, you know, if you've been listening to the show for any amount of time, you know how I feel about that slogan. And it's the slogan that I have a problem with, not the sentiment behind it. But as I said to my husband last night when he tried to explain a joke, that if you have to explain the joke, it doesn't work, right? If you, it's not immediately understandable when you say it, it's not funny. It doesn't work. Same thing with defund the police. When they explain it, no, we're talking about just moving the money to social services, to other areas that could help people. So every time if someone's having like a break, a mental health break, and you call 911, you don't have to worry that they're going to send a SWAT team out with guns and kill your troubled family member. But maybe you can get somebody who's qualified to deal with a mentally disturbed person. So I agree with the sentiment. Bad choice of words. And the Democrats suck at marketing, at framing, at bumper sticker sayings. We suck at it. Medicare for all should have worked, but you know, it didn't say enough. And single payer, which so many of us use, says nothing. Defund the police is the wrong slogan. It's just the wrong slogan. I don't know what the right slogan is, but that's not it. So yesterday, I'm reading the papers. You know, we get the Miami Herald delivered here, as everybody should. Please support your local newspaper. But I noticed this, and it was in the letters to the editor of all places. But it's really important, and so I wanted to share it with you. And it makes perfect sense to segue out of Cori Bush's story into this. The headline of the letter to the editor reads, "Coming 988. A mental health alternative, calling to 911. What? So that caught my attention. So let me read it to you. A new three-digit national phone number will be available in Florida to use as a helpline for behavioral health needs beginning in July of 2022. The number 988, which will replace the national 10-digit suicide prevention hotline, 800-273-TALK, will be an alternative to 911 to provide around-the-clock response for behavioral emergencies. Imagine calling 988 and speaking with someone who can send a mobile response team to your home with workers trained to de-escalate a crisis. What a concept, right? Diverting behavioral emergency calls from 911 to a call center with backup services would save money. Law enforcement would respond to fewer behavioral calls. Taxpayers would pay for fewer emergency room visits by uninsured patients. Fewer people with mental health issues would be homeless. With proper care, fewer people would die. But, and there's always a but, isn't there? But money is needed to pay for call centers, response teams, and centralized facilities to screen patients and provide immediate care. In Virginia, the money could come from a small fee added to phone bills, the same way 911 is funded. The Florida Mental Health Advocacy Coalition, a network that includes local chapters of the National Alliance on Mental Health and Mental Health America, will ask policymakers to embrace 988 as a cost-efficient way to address behavioral health crises. Our state legislators need to hear from citizens who understand that people having a behavioral health crisis need help, not handcuffs. Building a robust crisis response system will move us closer to a respectful and effective response to everyone who experiences a mental health, substance use, or suicidal crisis." Yes. Why do we have to wait till next July is my question. The fact that this is on the burner is so important. And that's what they're talking about when they say defund the police. Just move some of the funds from under the police jurisdiction or auspices or whatever the right word is over to programs like this. By the way, this letter was written by Gail Geist. She's the president of Florida Mental Health Advocacy Coalition in Fort Lauderdale. I may reach out to her and try to get her on the show to find out about that. See, that's what they should be saying. But I don't know how to say it in three words or two words. Defund the police. Rolls off the tongue real easy, but it makes people go, what the fuck? And the criticism being levied at Cori Bush right now is, so she's willing to spend an unlimited amount of money on her own security, but she doesn't want the rest of us to be protected? And the problem is that's not what she's saying at all. I get that. It's why the phrase disturbs me so much, because it is stupid. These are not marketing geniuses who came up with that. Defund the police. It brings forth the notion of, you know, police forces being disbanded because there's no money to pay them, instead of saying reallocate the resources. How about we, instead of defund the police, reallocate the resources? Mental health care, you know, again, I'm just thinking it through, but really, that kind of messaging will kill us. And to make matters worse, you have people like Hakeem Jeffries, excuse me, who jumped on it and like, that's the problem with the radical left. They keep doing shit like this radical left. It's like, stop it already. You know, as I told you yesterday with the chairman of the Florida Democratic Party not going after the Republican evildoers, but waging ongoing attacks on the Democratic Progressive Caucus of Florida. This will not end well. If there's this kind of infighting between these two factions, between in intra-party stuff, we're no better than, well, we're no better than, you know, the Republicans. We're no better than their divide. And I've said for a long time, yeah, we do need new parties. Not only do we need a new Republican Party, obviously, but we need, you know, we need a new party for disaffected Democrats. The Democratic Party is split. There is the progressives and there is the Jim Clyburn, Hillary Clinton contingent. Do I think we can work together? Yeah, I think we have so far, but not if this sniping continues. Not at all. So anyway, yes, reform the police. Demilitarize the police. I'm seeing a lot of great suggestions in the chat room, but defund the police? You know, here's the problem. In normal terms, it wouldn't be a problem. On the left, we do not march to a single drummer. We don't get the party-authored talking points distributed to us every morning and march in lockstep. We just do not. Nobody tells me what to say or think. I do that for myself, but it's also the reason why we are all over the place, right? We've got people a lot further to the left than I am. In fact, I often talk about them as going so far to the left, they come out on the right. That's like the Glenn Greenwalds. Seriously, he's just gone, whoo, around the corner. We've got a long way to go. And the question is, I don't know if we get there. It's a race against time, literally. And with what they're doing on the right, I don't know. And then in the meantime, COVID. So we'll take a quick break. Our guest will be along in a moment. We'll come back with Jules Boykoff in just a few minutes and talk the politics of the Olympics. But first, our friend Lauren Mayer, we haven't heard one of her new songs lately. And I figured, oh, it was just about time for one, because this one is just out. And, you know, it talks to what we're dealing with right now. So take it away, Lauren Mayer. We could all use a good song right about now. Here we go.
As things get worse, some people curse any public health suggestion. To those of you who take that view, I'd like to ask one question. If you don't need a mask because God will protect you, then why do you need a gun? If you think public health doesn't affect you, are you a community of one? Do you realize your selfishness is the reason we're still in this mess? And if you won't wear a mask because you don't need protection, then why do you need a gun? If you're not vaccinated because you listen to Tucker, that fact-denying ignorant jerk, well, you should know that hypocritical had to get his shot to go to work. And if your crowd would just get vaccinated, you wouldn't have to wear those masks you hated. And if you don't need the vaccine because you're too macho, then what are you compensating for with the gun?
Good question.
People give so many crazy reasons for being so darn contrarian. With the highest virus rates in the reddest states, we should call the latest one the Darwin variant. And if you think freedom means the government can't tell you what to do, you're full of bunk unless you think we don't need speed limits, traffic lanes, or stoplights, and we should be allowed to drive drunk. Your behavior hurts the rest of the nation, unlike gay marriage and women's procreation. So if you're not vaccinated because of something you saw on Facebook, you ruin everyone's fun. On idiocy, you sure got dibs if you're willing to risk COVID to own the libs. And if you think it's patriotic to be so stupid, you hurt yourselves more in the long run. And if you won't wear a mask because whatever stupid reason, well, if it weren't for you schmucks, this whole thing would be done.
Ah, Lauren Mayer, everyone. Boom. All right, there you go. Lauren Mayer. And now I think we can bring our guest in. Jules Boykoff is somebody that, hey, Jules, there he is. Hey, welcome back. I don't know, you probably don't remember, but we spoke 5 years ago. It was right before the Rio Olympics, and your book, Power Games, had just come out, a political history of the Olympics. And we had a fascinating conversation, and I'm looking at what's going on right now, and I thought, who can I talk to about this? And I'm like, oh my God, Jules Boykoff. And sure enough, there you are. You're still a professor at Pacific University in Oregon, still writing about the Olympics. You're working with a friend of the show, Dave Zirin, as well. Thank you so much for being here today.
Oh, it's my great pleasure to be back. And of course, I remember from those years ago, and I appreciate you having me back again. Thank you.
Oh, it's my pleasure. So I know it's probably a stupid question, but have you been watching the Tokyo 2020 Olympics?
I have been doing some selective watching of the games. There are particular politically minded athletes who I'm following. I'm also in contact with some people who are in Tokyo, so I want to make sure I can follow how they're doing. And so I've been watching a little bit. I haven't been a total diehard. I haven't been getting up at 3 a.m. What about you?
Well, not getting up at 3 a.m. at all and watching some of the stuff. But, I don't know if it's just me and the cynic in me is louder these days, or NBC is just really doing an awful job in this Olympics. I know that's subjective, but do you agree with my assessment?
Well, I've been hearing a lot of criticism of NBC's coverage. I think
terrible.
That's pretty par for the course. Every 4 years or two, I guess, we get a dose of criticism for NBC. I think maybe for me, the bigger issue is that it's pretty tough to be cheering for an optional sporting spectacle in the midst of a global health pandemic. And it's not just that it's a global health pandemic, but it's actually a pandemic that is surging in the host city and country. And the Olympics are yet ramming ahead, even though the local population is actually against the games. At least in the lead into these Olympics, there was poll after poll that found that a huge majority, we're talking in some of these polls, more than 80% of the population did not want the Olympics this summer. And so when the host city and country doesn't want the Olympics, maybe that makes it a little bit tougher for some folks to kind of get on board and cheer all the way as well.
Oh, without a doubt. And here's the thing, you're on Twitter at Jules Boykoff, B-O-Y-K-O-F-F, and you have a lot of photographs protests going on in Japan. Lots of signs. In fact, today's opening show card, here, I'll put it up on the screen, I think, maybe. There it is. It shows a protest in Japan. It says, kill the poor. Olympics kill the poor. Sorry, my screen is kind of messed up here. But this is happening, and we're certainly not seeing that coverage, are we? Have you seen any of the coverage of the protests in Japan here?
Mm-hmm. Well, there is, first of all, that's a great photograph, and you're seeing it. It's right in front of the official Olympic rings that sit across from the big national stadium that was built specifically for these Olympics, which, as your listeners and viewers will know, sits largely hollow during these games because fans are not allowed to attend these Olympics.
Right.
And I was there when that photo was taken. I was actually standing behind the person who took the photograph. And there was a lot of protest happening in July 2019. That was 1 year before the Olympics were supposed to happen. Of course, everybody knows that COVID came and they pushed them off for 1 year. And this is always a struggle around the Olympics, is to get media attention for both the actions that the activists take and also the grievances that animate those actions. And I have to say, although you haven't seen wall-to-wall coverage by any means of protests here in the United States of what's happening in Tokyo and around Japan, there, in my mind at least, has been more attention to the issues that those activists are raising. In other words, I feel like COVID has very much stripped the varnish off the larger Olympic project and really kind of pulled away a lot of the myths that people tend to believe in around the Olympics, and given more space for critics like those activists there in that photograph to level their critiques of the Olympic machine. And, you know, the Olympics tend to bring out the best in athletes and also the worst in host cities. And what we've definitely seen with these Olympics, it also has brought out the worst in the people who run the Olympics, and that is the International Olympic Committee. They have just pushed ahead, been super rude to their hosts every step of the way, said that this was going to happen if there was a state of emergency, said that, quote unquote, barring Armageddon, these Olympics were going to happen. And apparently they weren't joking around. They were going to ram these Olympics down the gullets of an unwilling population, to the danger of that population and also to the danger of Olympic athletes. One just last point on this is that, you know, the COVID rates are going through the roof in Tokyo and Japan, but they're also rising inside of the so-called Olympic bubble. Right now, as we speak, there are around 400 cases of coronavirus with people who are linked to the Olympics, including the first cluster just the other day in the Greek Olympic contingent, where there were six cases among one team of swimmers. And so, you know, the life of these athletes were put in danger to stage these games. We don't yet know the long-term health implications of coronavirus. We could be putting these athletes, these volunteers, these people with the Olympic movement, if you will, on a slow path to a lot of struggle in their lives for, again, what is an optional sporting spectacle.
Right. While you were talking, I put up some more photos from your Twitter stream of these massive protests in Japan. I mean, from your pictures, at least, it looks like they're pretty widespread. But again, there aren't tourists there to see the Olympics, so the coverage of it has been moderated, let's put it that way. I haven't seen, aside from your Twitter stream, I haven't seen these pictures anywhere.
Yeah, there have been a few reporters, and maybe I should give them a little bit of credit here. Actually, on CNN, Selena Wang on CNN has actually been attending protests. Wow. Monica Montgomery, also based in Japan, has been attending protests and did a real nice video piece for Vice for people that want to get a flavor for the street heat that has been generated around the Olympics. So there have been a few people that I think do deserve credit. But yeah, by and large, this is not the kind of thing that you're going to see on NBC, which, by the way, you know, kicks in around 40% of the International Olympic Committee's revenues. Huh. And so you're not going to see that kind of stuff kind of putting a dent in the Olympic facade, but it's getting out there. It's eking out. CNN's no small media.
No, that's good. It's been appearing there. Right. No, I'm glad to hear that they are covering it. We watch CNN spottily here, but I hadn't seen it. Jules Boykoff is with us talking about the Olympics. You know, before COVID even reared its ugly head, I was concerned about the 2020 Olympics being in Tokyo because Fukushima had a huge nuclear accident there not too long ago, and there's radiation. I mean, I said after that if I were supposed to be going to the 2020 Olympics, this is obviously pre-COVID, I don't know that I would go because of Fukushima. So that nobody's even talking about anymore. And in fact, I saw one of the package things that NBC does, there were some athletes in Fukushima, and I was like, why are they going there? Should also mention, today happens to be the 76th anniversary, I think, of Hiroshima. So, I don't know if there's been any mention of that or if there would be. It's kind of a weird thing to deal with at a time when you're over there in their country, but a lot of stuff all in at one time that can be a powder keg, I think.
Yeah, I'm really glad you mentioned that, Nicole, because you're right. It really hasn't been discussed in a critical kind of way. And if we rewind the tape to 2013, when Shinzo Abe, then Prime Minister of Japan, was standing in front of the International Olympic Committee trying to get their vote so that Tokyo could stage the games, people in the IOC, the International Olympic Committee, were very concerned about Fukushima. It only happened in March 2011, just a few short months before they were voting. And Shinzo Abe at the time said that everything was, quote unquote, under control. And that was a lie. I mean, people in Fukushima were jumping up and down saying that is just simply not true. Things are not under control. Oh. The second lie that he really said was that the games would be called the recovery games because they would help Fukushima recover. Well, Dave Zirin, who you mentioned before at The Nation magazine, and I actually traveled to Fukushima in July 2019. And we saw that, first of all, things were not under control. And everybody we interviewed there, from elected officials to people on the street, were still furious about that comment because they viewed it very much so as a lie. But also on top of that, the Olympics did not help the region recover. In fact, many people we spoke with, including a professor at Kansai University called Satoko Itani, pointed out that actually that slowed down the recovery in Fukushima because a lot of the cranes and other materials were brought to Tokyo to prepare for the games and were not used in Fukushima. So yes, they had a spectacle softball game and baseball game down in Fukushima, and they produced a few little segments for NBC. But really, the reality is that the people in Fukushima were left behind. All they got in the end, unfortunately for them, was a photo op with Thomas Bach, the president of the International Olympic Committee, who rolled into town against the wishes of many atomic bomb survivors, who said, "We don't want you here, Mr. Bach." And he stood and did some photo ops.
Oh,
and
wow.
That just only infuriated people further. So yeah, it's an important part of this story that really isn't getting discussed.
Not at all. Politics, though, does play a big part in the Olympics. I mean, where else are you going to see Cuba represented alongside of the United States, alongside of China and the Russian Olympic Committee? If Russia was banned from the Olympics for doping, why are there athletes there?
Yes, I think this points us to the power politics that sit at the center of the Olympic Games. As you'll know, Russia is a big player in the Olympics. They actually hosted the games not that long ago, especially the Winter Olympics. They do very well in, and they hosted in 2014 in Sochi and did the International Olympic Committee a huge favor. They spent loads of money to make those Olympics happen. Just to rewind, they were originally supposed to cost $12 billion, those games. They ended up costing $51 billion for the Sochi Olympics. They were a total budget buster, broke all records, and it actually cost more than all previous Winter Olympics combined. And they put out a real show. That's the kind of thing that the International Olympic Committee both likes and appreciates in the long run. And so when you have a power broker like that, even when they're busted for doing doping, which some people have categorized as basically state-sanctioned and state-run doping, they basically get a little bit of a slap on the wrist. Now, some of those athletes might say, "Well, I wanted to hear my national anthem when I was up on the podium and I didn't get to, so it might not feel like a slap in the wrist." But, you know, for the rest of the world, you're kind of like, "Wow, you got to still participate in the Olympics, even though your country was busted in a widely noted doping scandal."
But these stories happen at the Olympics, and there are the, you know, the inter-country rivalries and things like that. But money is a big issue. So one of the things that we talked about the last time we spoke was why a country in this day and age even wants the Olympics. Now, Los Angeles is scheduled to host the Olympics, in 2028?
Right.
And there's a big movement afoot not to. In fact, you have a book, I guess, called No Olympians. Is this it?
That's it.
And tell us about it. Tell us what this is all about.
Sure. Well, for starters, the reason why cities still bid on the Olympics, and they are more few and far between these days, is because it's always political and economic elites that do the bidding. In all my days studying the Olympics, I have never seen a grassroots bid from working people in the city that really want to bring the games to town. No, of course, it's well-connected political and economic elites. And Los Angeles is no exception, where the mayor, Eric Garcetti, was one of the big prime movers in boosting those Olympics alongside Casey Wasserman, who really led the bid. He's kind of a media mogul in town and a marketing mogul. And those two really rammed through the bid. It was supposed to only cost $5.3 billion, those Olympics. It's already gone up to 6.9, and we barely got the show rolling there in Los Angeles. But more to your point, there has been activism against those Olympics from the beginning. A rambunctious group of activists that emerged out of the Democratic Socialists of America chapter in Los Angeles, and more specifically out of their Housing and Homelessness Committee. The group is called No Olympics LA. And in my mind, they're very much on the cutting edge of activism. They've been teaming up in transnational fashion with activists in Japan. They led a huge get together in July 2019 in Japan with organizers there, where you brought anti-Olympics activists from around the world to share strategies. So the big contingent from Los Angeles, there are people from Paris that are supposed to be hosting in 2024, and as well as past hosts like London, Seoul, South Korea, Pyeongchang, South Korea. And they brought everybody together to strategize. And, you know, it is a battle in Los Angeles right now. I think that the Tokyo Olympics have really shown that nothing is for sure. And that just like coronavirus really upturned the Tokyo Games, climate change and wildfires are becoming part of everyday life in Los Angeles. And that could very easily upstage these Olympics that are planned for 2028. So this group of people has allies across town, from Black Lives Matter to groups in Koreatown who are fighting against gentrification and for the rights of the unhoused. And they are not giving up the fight. And they're an interesting group to follow. No Olympics LA.
I'll bet. And so when this book, No Olympians, came out last April, in the midst of the pandemic, hard time to release a book. Does it specifically deal with the situation in Los Angeles, or the movement afoot that I believe is happening in other cities around the world, where all of a sudden people are going, you know what? There are lives on the line here. We saw the protests in Japan. We don't want the Olympics here. Take care of people here at home first.
Right.
So is this just LA, or is it everywhere?
It's both, yeah. So the book does focus a lot on these groups in Los Angeles, but as a way of talking about a bigger story about the Olympics and how, just like you said, Nicole, more and more people are waking up to the endemic downsides of the Olympics. And if I can just say what they are,
if I may, really quickly.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't matter if it's the Tokyo Olympics in 2020, 2021, or the Los Angeles Olympics in 2028, or the Atlanta Games in 1996, there are problems that are ingrained in the games. And one of those is overspending. Mm-hmm. There was a study by Oxford University that found every single Olympics going back to 1960, for which there is reliable data, went over its initial budget, every single one. Tokyo is a shining example. It was supposed to cost $7.3 billion. Wow. Now it's costing more like $30 billion. And so a second trend is gentrification of the Olympic city and displacement of working people. Sometimes this happens through just brass tax forced eviction, as when I lived in Rio de Janeiro, I saw it with my own two eyes, from favela communities getting displaced, some 77,000 people in Rio kicked out of their homes to make way for Olympic venues. Or it sometimes happens through the maybe velvet glove, if you will, of gentrification, where it increases prices of housing and people have to move. That happened in London, where I was also living during the Olympics. I saw it in Newham, one of the five host boroughs, where the housing prices went through the roof. The number of people who are unhoused in that borough went through the roof. A third trend is the militarization of public space. In order to protect the Olympic spectacle, essentially security officials in the home city and country use the games like their own private cash machine to get all the money, special weapons, special laws that they'd never be able to get during normal political times. And this is all over the place, every single Olympics, every single time. And the fourth trend that really has been getting a lot of attention is greenwashing. I think when you were talking about Fukushima, you were hedging toward greenwashing, yeah, right? Making it seem like it's just going to be this green heyday. It's going to really improve the environment, when in reality, nothing of the sort tends to happen. And when you take corruption, which has also become endemic to the Olympics, including serious allegations around bribery for these Tokyo 2020 games, when you take that, add it in and mix it up a little bit, you've got a pretty toxic brew that many people just aren't wanting to have come into their city.
Wow. And the fact is that the host city, the host country, doesn't have a lot of control once they win the rights to the game. Like, I don't know when Japan had to bid on the 2020 games, but a decade earlier, I'm guessing, right? When it was delayed because of COVID last year, and please correct me if I got this wrong, but the way I understand it is, it wasn't up to Japan. It was the IOC that they called the shots. And when there was some discussion of the games may still not go on, just, you know, days leading up to the start of these Olympics, that's when I heard it's not up to Japan. The IOC calls the shot. Japan doesn't have any say in the matter. Is that true?
Yes, it is true, Nicole. You are exactly right. And I feel like these Olympics have really opened a lot of eyes to that reality. The host city contract that Olympic host cities sign with the International Olympic Committee are notoriously lopsided in favor of the IOC, the International Olympic Committee. And as you say, there are provisions inside of that host city contract that give the termination powers, the power to cancel the Olympics, to the International Olympic Committee unilaterally. Wow. And so the Prime Minister of Japan, an elected official, Prime Minister Yoshihide Suga, was asked under pressure by his local population whether he was thinking about canceling the Olympics. And he was forced to concede in public that he didn't have the power to cancel the Olympics. Right. So in other words, the host city contract essentially reduced him to a supplicant of the International Olympic Committee. And it's not just Tokyo. It's Los Angeles. If you look at the contract that LA signed, it's Paris, the 2024 games. This is part of the plan from the beginning. And we saw what the downsides are when you let an organization like the IOC, that's pretty ruthless, money driven, they basically get $9 out of every $10 from either a broadcaster or from a corporate sponsor. So for them, going ahead with the Olympics during a pandemic is no big deal, so long as you can have it screened on TVs around the world and those broadcaster revenues and corporate sponsorship fees continue to flow into their coffers, no problem. If it's a major super spreader event for the host city and host nation, that's not really their
big
thing.
That's not their problem. And then, you know, you can't help but notice last night we're watching some of the track and field events, and it's a massive stadium that's sitting empty. That's revenue that I guess Japan was hoping on to recoup some of their costs that they can't get back. So as much as the overages and as much as this spectacle costs them, multiply that exponentially because of the losses they're suffering from no crowds being allowed to be there.
Yep. In fact, you're pinpointing one of the major sources of revenue that the Tokyo organizers were banking on, the local organizers. Mm. They were expecting around $800 million to come from ticket sales. Wow. And that quickly went from $800 million to essentially zero. And so, yeah, that only hurt the losses. But the losses were pretty darn big to begin with. I mean, they overspent like no one's business. But yes, key point you're raising.
Wow. So, and it doesn't look to get better. I mean, you brought up climate change. Things, I can't even imagine what things are going to be like 6 years from now, which is when LA is going to have the Olympics. I don't even want to imagine it. Jules Boykoff, there's another element here, and that is of activism, of protest. And very famously, probably the most famous moment of any Olympics was John Carlos and Tommy, what's his last name? I'm sorry?
Smith.
Raising their fists, like a Black Power thing. And this was a photograph, this was an image that is iconic now. But we're also living in a time when if a football player takes a knee during the national anthem to protest police brutality against, you know, Black men, they all freak out. I thought I read somewhere that the Olympics said that activism, you know, personal protest would be allowed at these games. And then we saw this woman, tell me her name again. The woman who did the protest, did the cross.
Oh, Raven Saunders.
Raven Saunders. We're looking at Raven Saunders' picture. So tell us about her. What happened here?
Sure. Well, just to back up, just like you said, there's long been a rule on the books of the International Olympic Committee's Olympic Charter, which states very directly that athletes cannot engage in any sort of political or religious demonstrations inside of the Olympic sphere. And when Carlos and Smith did that in 1968, and the white sprinter from Australia, Peter Norman, stood by in solidarity wearing an Olympic Project for Human Rights button, mm-hmm. that actually galvanized the International Olympic Committee to make that rule. There's been a lot of pushback recently from athletes who are increasingly viewing themselves as athlete workers and organizing around this issue. And because of all the pressure on this rule, it's called Rule 50 in the Olympic Charter, right before the Olympics, the IOC decided to change the rule just a little bit to create a little bit more space for athletes to demonstrate. So for your listeners and viewers who have been watching women's soccer, for example, you probably have noticed before the games, a lot of the women are taking a knee, and that is now permitted so long as it is before the match. But what Raven Saunders did there in celebrating her silver medal in the shot put was still illegal according to the rules. Medal stand protests were deemed illegal. Any kind of protest during the opening or closing ceremonies were still deemed illegal. And let me tell you something kind of amazing, Nicole. If you go on the official Olympic channel and you Google up John Carlos and Tommy Smith, and you'll find a video there that talks about how courageous these men were. This is the official Olympic channel here, and how they were legends of the Olympics for standing up for what they believe in. And yet even these slightly revised rules that I'm talking about around Rule 50 still prohibit an athlete today from doing something like Smith and Carlos. In other words, the International Olympic Committee is basically milking Smith and Carlos for money off of their Olympic channel, while at the same time preventing anyone from doing something courageous. And so it'll be really interesting to see what happens with Raven Saunders. The United States Olympic and Paralympic Committee has backed Saunders and said that it will not impose a penalty. The International Olympic Committee then went and huddled and decided they were going to have a conversation about what to do. But then, unfortunately, Ms. Saunders' mother passed away. And so they put it on the back burner for now. But there are a lot of people, including myself, that will be very interested in seeing what happens. And let's just hope that the IOC decides not to penalize her. She, after all, explained exactly what she was doing. It was a gesture meant in support of all people who are oppressed from around the world. It wasn't against any necessarily any kind of group. And so it'll be interesting to see what the International Olympic Committee does when it emerges from its huddle.
So I was wrong, though. They didn't say that personal protests of this sort would be allowed. I thought I read that somewhere.
They did, but only in particular areas. So like before the game, when you're in the mixed zone talking to reporters. By the way, you could always be freely speaking in the mixed zone. So they did some of that kind of stuff as well. But there were still some areas, even though they slightly adjusted the rules, where they said, nope, it's still verboten on the medal podium at the opening and closing ceremonies. So, you know, athletes that have been organizing against this rule have pointed out that they are humans first and athletes second, and that they have human rights. And one of those in the UN Universal Declaration of Human Rights, Article 19, states very directly that you cannot interfere with somebody's political expression. Well, Rule 50 in the Olympic Charter is clear and obvious interference. And so athletes have been pushing back as humans and also as athletes to try to change that.
Wow. We are speaking with Jules Boykoff. And if you're finding this fascinating as I do, do check out his website, julesboykoff.org. I'll put links to that, your Twitter feed and all that on the blog at nicolesandler.com, where I post today's show. Always available. Share it with anyone. I'm not behind a paywall or anything. So what happens next? When do these games even end? I know that the excitement over them is not very high this year. In fact, I've read that NBC is going to have to be offering a lot of make goods to their advertisers because they're not delivering the audience that they promised. And maybe it's because a lot of people are saying, how could you even do this when we're in the midst of a pandemic? It's the wrong time. It's the wrong place. It's the wrong year. Do you see a change coming, or are they just going to keep plodding along as they've been, even though emotions or attitudes have changed toward them?
Well, because of the postponement of the Tokyo Games for a year, we have a very short timeline to the next Olympics.
Right.
And the next Olympics are also extraordinarily controversial because they're going to be staged in Beijing, China.
Oh, God.
Where you have human rights workers around the globe who are very upset about this reality because of the treatment of ethnic Muslim Uyghurs in the Xinjiang region, because of the long-term treatment of Tibetans, because of what's going on in terms of squelching democracy in Hong Kong. Yeah. So all things that you might think would push back against the ideals in the Olympic Charter. So if anyone thinks the controversy around the Olympics is going away anytime soon, it is very much not. And when the Olympics close here this weekend, and then you'll have the Paralympics that'll open a short while after that and run through September, then after that, all eyes will turn to Beijing. And so there'll be plenty of criticality to come when it comes to the Olympic Games.
Oh, boy. It's a never-ending thing. And you're right, because these are the 2020 Olympics that are wrapping up this weekend. Those will be the 2022 Olympics. That's just next year. So there's not the usual two-year separation. And yes, it's China. And oh, my goodness. And COVID. I don't think in a year from now we'll be out of the woods either. So there's a lot going on. You've got a lot to write about, Jules Boykoff. Thank you so much for joining us. As I knew it would be, this is fascinating. Even without dealing with the individual sports and the athletes, some of whom have remarkable stories that kind of get buried under all this other nonsense around it. I feel for them. I felt for Simone Biles. I feel for the other athletes who are caught up in the middle of this, who just want to do what they've trained their entire lives for. And it's I guess, difficult to do sometimes. Anyway, Jules, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate it.
Thank you, Nicole. My pleasure.
Thank you. All right. You take care.
You too.
All right. Bye-bye. And with that, we're done. That's another day, another show. I got some new toys here for those of you watching the video and seeing my mess on the screen. Have a weekend. It's a weekend. We'll see you Monday. Thanks for listening, everyone. Be careful, please. If you go out, wear a mask and keep your distance. Okay. I'll leave you with the news. Thanks for listening, everyone. See you Monday.
I read the news today. Oh, boy.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
The Labor Department Friday morning released the July jobs report, and it was a good one. The U.S. added 943,000 jobs in July, the unemployment rate falling to 5.4% from 5.9% last month. Employment growth exceeded the 850,000 job gain projected by economists. This data comes as Congress works on an infrastructure package that supporters say will add even more jobs. Speaking of which, Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer on Thursday night moved to call a vote to end debate for Saturday. He'll need 60 votes to move forward after a day of behind-the-scenes haggling failed to produce any kind of breakthrough. Schumer had hoped to hold the vote Thursday night, but finally adjourned it around midnight until Saturday morning. About 15 senators are heading to Wyoming Friday to attend the funeral of Senator Mike Enzi. Remember the toxic battles over raising the debt ceiling? Well, they're coming back. The debt ceiling simply clears the way for the nation to pay the bills for the spending that Congress has already authorized. So it's archaic and redundant, but it gives the Republicans another way to obstruct the Democrats' agenda. Keep in mind that in the 4 years of the previous administration, Democrats didn't fight raising the debt ceiling even once. But now that a Democrat is in the White House, here we go again. It was Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell, the same guy who ignored Trump's red ink when he was Majority Leader, said that the Democrats should lift the debt ceiling on their own if they intend to pass a $3.5 trillion reconciliation bill, vowing they would receive no Republican help to do so. Strap in. This looks to get even uglier. Speaking of ugly, in COVID news, we're getting updated info as the scientists learn more about the Delta variant of the virus. CDC Director Rochelle Walensky on Thursday said the vaccines continue to work well for Delta with regards to severe illness and death. They prevent it. But, she said, what they can't do anymore is prevent transmission. Experts have warned that while breakthrough infections of vaccinated people are expected, it's the unvaccinated who are most at risk. And again, Florida remains the COVID capital of the United States right now. Broward County's Memorial Healthcare System's six hospitals admitted 1,600 patients in one day this week. Patients were lined up in beds in cafeterias and in a conference room. They say 97% of the COVID cases at Memorial are unvaccinated people. President Biden had a busy Thursday. He unveiled another piece of his plan to fight the climate crisis, announcing a new target that half a vehicle sold in the U.S. by 2030 will be battery electric, fuel cell electric, or plug-in hybrid. Representatives from Ford, GM, and Stellantis, that's the new parent company of Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, and others, joined Biden at the White House for the announcement. Conspicuously absent, Tesla. It's an American company who makes nothing but electric vehicles. When asked if Tesla being a non-union company was the reason it wasn't included Thursday, White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki replied, quote, "Well, these are the three largest employers of the United Auto Workers, so I'll let you draw your own conclusions." The UAW has been trying to organize Tesla workers, so far to no avail. Well, Biden's efforts at mitigating the dangers posed by climate change comes as destructive wildfires are blazing more frequently and more intensely. The Dixie wildfire just wiped out much of the gold rush town of Greenville in Northern California. And for those of us on the East Coast, the coming months could be devastating if NOAA's new prediction of a more active Atlantic hurricane season comes true. President Biden on Thursday also signed a bill to award congressional gold medals to the police forces that responded to the insurrection at the Capitol on January 6th. The award is Congress's highest expression of national appreciation for distinguished achievements and contributions by individuals or institutions. 21 House Republicans voted against awarding the medals. President Biden thanked the officers, quote, "for protecting our Capitol and maybe more importantly, for protecting our Constitution and saving the lives of duly elected members of the Senate, in the House, and our staffs." The awards come as we continue to learn the full picture of the former guy's lies and further details about his incredible efforts to overturn the election results. And finally, Friday marks the 56th anniversary of President Lyndon Johnson signing the Voting Rights Act of 1965. It was a landmark piece of federal legislation that prohibits racial discrimination in voting. President Johnson, who famously hailed from Texas, would be rolling over in his grave if that were possible, as current Texas Governor Greg Abbott tries to pass new, even more restrictive anti-voting laws. You'll recall that the Texas Democrats left the chamber during the regular session, denying the Republicans of a quorum, so they were unable to vote on this bill. The session ended, so Governor Abbott called a special session in order to pass the voter suppression bills. This time, the Senate Democrats left the state for the whole month. They went to D.C., where they continued to lobby the senators to pass the For the People Act and the John Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act. Well, the special session in Texas ended with still no quorum, so Abbott called another special legislative session to begin this weekend. Note that he did not call a special session when the state dealt with multiple crises, from hurricanes and record flooding to that big freeze that left most of the state without power. But he's continuing nonstop special sessions to pass laws that'll make it harder for a portion of the Texas population to vote. The Democrats have not committed to when or whether they'll return home. Stay tuned. And that's just a bit of what's news for now. I'm Nicole Sandler. If you appreciate these reports on the Nicole Sandler Show, I hope you'll consider making a contribution. My work is fully listener-supported, and I can't do it without your help. Find out more at NicoleSandler.com, and please click on that donate button.